Well, good morning, Pleasant View. As you have been connecting this morning to this live stream, you have been listening to Andrew Harvey play various choruses and hymns on the piano. So hopefully you have enjoyed listening to that. Well, welcome to May. Can you believe that we are in May already? Here we are. So being in a new month, we are going to do a new hymn of the month. The hymn is called Christ Will Be My Hideaway. It's a brand new hymn. I introduced it on Wednesday night when we were here practicing at the church. And hopefully you had a chance to listen to that. And if you haven't, it's okay. You're going to hear it again today, or you're going to hear it for the first time this morning. I'm going to read our call to worship from Proverbs, and it is Proverbs 2, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 8. So if you would, as a habit here of Pleasant View, as we read the scriptures, we stand. So if you would, stand with me. It says this: My son, if you receive my words and treasure up my commandments with you, making your ear attentive to wisdom and inclining your heart to understanding. Yes, if you call out for insight and raise your voice for understanding, if you seek it like silver and search for it as hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He is a shield to those who walk in integrity, guarding the paths of injustice and watching over the way of his saints. He's covering us as his saints. Again, I've already introduced the hymn of the month. It is Christ Will Be My Hideaway. Now, I'm looking forward to this because we get to sing it for 5 weeks this month. So, if you will, join with me as we sing this song together.
I will dwell within the shelter of the God who reigns above. I will rest beneath the shadow of the mighty King of love. Though a sickness hides in darkness, though a destroys by day, I will stand upon his promises. Christ will be my hideaway. To protect me when they hear my Savior call. Sovereign hands are ever ready to uphold me should I fall. Safe beneath his wings of refuge, all my fears are kept. Shielded by
Be seated.
What a comforting song in these days that we live in. Praise the Lord that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Well, normally, again, when we are together, we would pause and take time to collect an offering from the saints here at Pleasant View, and that's what this time is for. I do want to say that I thank you so much for being faithful in your giving. It's really a measure of God's grace upon our church here at Pleasant View, so praise the Lord for that. And again, we don't have any way of online giving or anything like that. We're just asking people to mail in their gifts to Pleasant View Baptist Church, 8931 Garrett Highway, Oakland, Maryland, 21550. And the Lord is using y'all and using that to provide for the needs that this church has. So praise the Lord for that. There are other ways, again, to offer yourself during this time. Just a simple phone call to someone that maybe you're thinking about, or taking a look through our church's directory, or even a neighbor, and just calling them up and spending some time on the phone talking to them. That's a great way to encourage folks and to kind of touch base with them, pray on the phone with them. We're going to see in today's message how Paul used prayer really as acknowledgement of how much he loved the church at Ephesus and the people there. So anyway, those are ways that you can give. Certainly we encourage you to look to the Lord, and as he provides, you give an offering to him. Let's pray together. Father, we want to thank you today for your goodness and your grace upon the believers here at Pleasant View Baptist Church. We want to thank you again for our audience, which is a little beyond just our church this morning and goes out to people who are watching online. Father, we certainly want them to give where they regularly attend a church. And if they don't attend, we want them to know that you want them first. You're looking to have their hearts. You desire to have them as your own children. And Lord, when we're yours, it's not an effort to give to you, Lord. It's a blessing. It's an encouragement. It's our joy. So we want to thank you for that. And we pray that you would take the offerings that have been mailed into this church, and as we continue to plan for the future and look to see what you might want to do to use the people of Pleasant View Baptist Church in order to proclaim the gospel here where we live and around the world. Father, again, we pray you'd take each offering and again, we would use it for your purposes and for your glory. Lord, we love you today. We thank you again for giving us this time together. Please bless this singing and this praying and everything that we're going to do today, opening up the Word of God and hearing from you. Bless it, Lord. Draw us into your power and into your presence as we hear you speak to us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to be singing a phrase in just a moment. Now to the King on the throne who was and is to come, and to the Lamb who was slain, be glory. We're going to sing that phrase several times during this song. He is our God. And let us lift up our praises to him, to the King on the throne who was and is to come, and to the Lamb who was slain, be glory. Let's sing this together. 2, 3. Sing it out, church.
Who can light the fires of a thousand burning suns blazing in the heavens? There is only one. He is our God. And who commands the nations, building up and tearing down, silencing his rivals? There is only one. He is our God. He is our God. Holy, you alone are holy, matchless in your glory. Holy God. Save us when we turned away as love. Conquer us with kindness. There is only one. He is our God. He is our God. Holy, you alone are holy. Like you worthy, you.
first book of John says that the Word became flesh. So we're asking him this morning as we dig into his Word and as our pastor opens up the Word, we're asking the Word of God to speak to us. We're asking Christ to speak to us when we open up his Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us as sinners. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Oh, the glory of your presence. Your presence.
Good morning. It's good to be together on the Lord's Day. Let's spend some time together as a church in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we are your temple. And we, as we are united with Christ, we are your people, Lord. And we humble ourselves before your great and mighty hand. Father, we put ourselves before you and we confess, Lord, that we are created beings and you are the creator. And because of that, Father, you hold all power and all right to speak in our lives and to do what you will with our lives. Lord, we humble ourselves and admit our sin before you. Father, I'm amazed at what great lengths I go to and what this country has gone to preserve and protect our physical lives. And yet, what little lengths I will go to safeguard my spiritual condition and my spiritual life comparatively. Father, we have totally upended our way of life, Lord, just to preserve this fleeting physical life that we have. But we so often, Father, neglect and forsake the spiritual disciplines that would strengthen and secure our hope and our faith in Christ. Lord, and as the apostle urges us that we are supposed to fearfully work out our salvation, Lord, and constantly checking whether our heart is truly toward you, truly for you, truly altogether given unto the Lord Jesus. So, Father, convict us, Lord, of areas that we have harbored secret sins, and, Lord, nothing is secret before your eyes. And so, Father, we confess, Father, that we are sinful, and it's only by Christ's righteousness that we can even approach you and pray. Lord, we pray that we are anxious. We admit that, Lord. We are anxious. We don't often trust your will for our lives, Lord. We're anxious, possibly financially. We look to the economy and to our jobs, Lord, for sustaining power in our lives and for security. Lord, I pray that you would help us to see past that and to recognize that you are our only source of sustenance. Father, we thank you for your scriptures. We ask that we would be more disciplined, Lord, as a church in studying them and really seeking out wisdom as the call to worship announced, Father, that would we seek out wisdom in your word, Lord, we would find you and we would find a knowledge of God. Father, we pray for those in our circles and then in the country at large who are suffering because of lost loved ones and people who have died. And Father, this is going on all around us all the time, every year, not just during the coronavirus, but Father, use these losses and these apparent tragedies, Lord, to turn our hearts as a nation toward you, that our hearts would be soft and supple in the work of the Holy Spirit and not hardened by our pride and our idolatry. Lord, we thank you so much for the book of Acts and what it's meant for us. And Lord, give us ears to hear what the heart of Paul is saying to the elders here and what he really just longs for the church and how much he bleeds for the church, that it would be healthy, that it would be faithful. Lord, give us ears to hear right now as we hear from the Word of God. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, Brother Daniel. Daniel's one of our elders here at Pleasant View, and we appreciate him and his work here very much. This morning, we're going to look at the book of Acts. So if you have a Bible there at home, grab one and sit down and open it up. Go to the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and then the book of Acts. And we're going to go over to chapter 20. We're going to read several verses here this morning because this is a story. I really don't know where to jump into the middle of a story at, so even though we are, so I'll have to do some backtrack as we read this text. But we're going to read verses 13 through 36 in Acts chapter 20. So let's read those together. It says, "But going ahead to the ship, we set sail for Assos, intending to take Paul aboard there. For so he had arranged, intending himself to go by land. And when he met us at Assos, we took him on board and went to Mytilene. And sailing from there, we came the following day opposite Chios. The next day, we touched at Samos. And the day after that, we went to Miletus. For Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus so that he might not have to spend time in Asia, for he was hastening to be at Jerusalem, if possible, on the day of Pentecost. Now from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church to come to him. And when they came to him, he said to them, 'You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews. How I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance toward God and of the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink back from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers or elders to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock, and from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things, I've shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.' And when he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. And there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and kissed him, being sorrowful, most of all because of the word that he had spoken, that they would not see his face again. And they accompanied him to the ship." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for these words, for this text, for this true
account for Luke, who documented these things for us to read on this morning. Oh, Father, it's not by accident and it's not by chance that these words are in Scripture. You have seen fit by your Spirit to make sure that they were inspired and put into the Bible that we read here this morning. So, Father, help us to learn by them. What do you want us to take away from this? How do you want to challenge us in this? What do you want to encourage us with in your word and these verses? Lord, make it known now to the people through this vessel, through me, Lord. And you know I'm a mere man, a sinful man. Lord, saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, so use me now as your instrument, I pray, that people may hear what you want them to hear and know. For your glory and for our good, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. The title of the message this morning is The Real Deal. The Real Deal. Now, what I see in Paul is that he's not playing around here. He's not just professing that he knows Christ. He's not just professing that he's a follower of Jesus. He's lived it out. And he's explaining this to these elders from a church that he loves very dearly in Ephesus. Now, I used the picture on the slide there for the title of a violin because I read some interesting things this week. Let me just set this up for a minute. All of us realize that there are many counterfeits around us in this world. We have counterfeit money. We have generic foods. We have off-brand clothing. And we have people who are hypocrites, who say they believe one thing and they act in a totally different way. One of the complaints from unbelievers about churches and about the church is that so-called Christians don't walk or live out what they talk. That's one of the complaints. That's why some people say they don't go to church. There's too many hypocrites. People there saying they believe one thing, and really, I've watched them on the job or out, and I've seen them live their lives in a completely contrary way to what they say they believe. They don't live it out. It's one of the complaints. They don't practice what they preach. Counterfeits may be like the original in some ways. Sometimes they're outwardly looking like a Christian. They profess Christ, but most can spot a fake. Have you ever heard about a Stradivarius violin? I remember Olivia, the violin that she plays, was found in a dumpster. And one of our friends, we were just going to paint it and hang it on a wall as a wall hanging because she likes violins and that kind of thing. And one of our friends said, no, don't do that. Let me look at it first. And he actually, those violins are glued together with this expandable type of glue. And he pried the top off very delicately. And because there was a small crack right underneath the black tailpiece on that violin. And when he took it apart, he found out that that thing was made in Germany in, I think, 1890-something. I can't remember the date right now. Now, that was a copy of a Stradivarius, and that's a very old violin. And Olivia makes it sound really nice. She plays some beautiful stuff out of that violin, but it came from a dumpster. Somebody didn't know what they had, you know, from the 1890s. But listen, a Stradivarius violin is a violin or a viola or a cello or maybe another stringed instrument built by members of the Italian family Stradivari or Stradivari. Other violins look like the Stradivarius, but they are mere copies. And in the 17th and 18th centuries, the designer Antonio Stradivari became famous for the quality sound that his handcrafted fine instruments produced. And depending on the condition, instruments made by Stradivari from 1700 to 1725 can be worth millions of dollars. As a matter of fact, in 2014, I looked this up, a viola built by Stradivari sold at an auction for $45 million. A little matchbox. And you can imagine that the buyer, if he was going to pay $45 million, wanted to make sure he was buying a 100% genuine, authentic, real Stradivarius.
He wanted the real deal. Now, as we read through the end of Acts 20, we hear the passionate heart of the Apostle Paul. He loved the Lord Jesus, and he loved people and wanted them to know that they could be reconciled to God through the Savior. So he traveled and he suffered for the sake of proclaiming the gospel of the grace of God so that people might be saved. Paul was the real deal. He was not sinless, but he was a forgiven sinner, now a saint, who wanted those around him to also be reconciled to the Creator and find their joy and purpose in him. When it came to knowing Christ and following Paul, or following Jesus, I mean, when it came to knowing Christ and following Jesus, Paul was the real deal. So that's what we're hearing today and we're looking at today in these ending verses in chapter 20. Now, the book of Acts is Luke's historical narrative of the early church. It's a history book of the Bible in the New Testament that Luke meticulously writes down facts and information. It is descriptive, and Luke is just a reporter who's getting the facts to us. It's descriptive and not necessarily prescriptive. In other words, they were working things out. This was the early church. They weren't doing everything right. Everything is not to be mimicked in the book of Acts just because the early church did it. They were learning by trial and error as the Spirit led them and corrected them in some things. So Luke, again, is writing Acts. And it is descriptive and not prescriptive. It is a testimony and not necessarily doctrinal. Things to be put in stone that this is how we ought to do things today. So Luke is simply telling us a true story. He's giving us facts. So today we're going to zoom in on the heart of the Apostle Paul. Luke was very close to Paul. And he watched him and he was with him. He traveled with him. And this is perhaps one of the most intimate, revealing passages concerning seeing what Paul really thought was important. And let me ask you a question. What is important to you in your faith? What is really important? You know, one of the things that this COVID-19 thing has done is it's helped us be isolated a little bit so we can think about what's really important. Because I remember before this came, we were running the rat race, right? And now we're just kind of to ourselves. Are you using this time to settle in with God? God, what are you speaking? What are you saying? What's really important? Or are you just so caught up in waiting till things get back to whatever normal is so that you can get back to it again? It's a question. It's always helpful for me to look on a map, even though I've never really traveled into these areas. But let me show you a map here this morning. This is the same map we put up last week, only I put a few stars on it. The yellow star is Troas there, and Paul makes this journey, and there's like a yellow mark down to the red star, which is Miletus, and I also put a star on Ephesus there, which is a green star. Those are things to note this morning. Now, let me keep that map up for just a minute while I just go down through these verses and show you what's happening. So it's Monday morning. Remember, we talked about the Lord's Day last week. It's Monday morning, and Paul and his companions are leaving Troas, the yellow star there. And in verse 13, it says, Paul sends his co-workers on ahead by ship to Assos. And notice here, I don't know if you caught this. It was in the text again last week. Luke, the writer of Acts, is writing himself back into the storyline by using the word we there, we. So Luke is actually traveling with them now. You'll see that in this morning's verses in verse 13. We set sail for Assos. He says it again in verse 14. He says it again later on in verse 15. We came the following day to Chios. So Luke is writing himself into the script here. He wants you to know he was along with them. He's a firsthand eyewitness to what's going on here. Then verse 13, Paul himself is going to travel by foot and meet them in Assos. In verse 14, they join up at Assos, and Paul boards the ship, and they travel together to Mytilene. Verse 15, the following day, they land ashore on the upper peninsula opposite of Chios. So if you look down below, they're on the opposite peninsula there. There's like a little peninsula sticking out on that map. So the very next day then, they leave Chios and they sail to Samos, verse 15. And one day later, they leave for Miletus, which is the Red Star. Verse 16, Paul decided to sail past Ephesus because he wanted to be in Jerusalem in time for Pentecost. He wasn't trying to be rude to the Ephesians. He loved that church. Matter of fact, that's why it's written in the text here. Luke wants you to know that there was something really in him that wanted to go to Ephesus, but he knew that the Spirit was leading him to be in Jerusalem, the Lord willing, by Pentecost there, so he could be in Jerusalem for Pentecost. He's on a tight schedule. That's why he wants to avoid going into Ephesus, because he gets in there with that church and he starts loving on that church, and they want to hear him talk and they want to hear what the Lord's doing and those kind of things. He thought it more expedient to call for the elders of that church. He would meet with them. He loved that church and wanted to communicate with them God's message. So verse 17, while in Miletus, he sent for the elders in the Ephesian church. In verse 17, he wanted to see them and exhort them and love on them. So he did it through the elders, which were representative of the church there in Ephesus. Why did he do it? Because Paul loved the church. He had planted many of these churches, or was co-planter of them. As people were led to the Lord, they would meet together as a church. And Paul birthed many of these churches. He had a deep love for them. Now, I'm going to give you all the points right now. And then you can back up Maddie and show them to him one at a time as I do them again. Because if I don't get through them today, we're going to pause and we'll catch up next week. But here they are. So here's what I see. Maybe the heading over this would be important priorities in the church, or important priorities that Paul saw in what a church should be like. All right, number one, sacrificing for others in order to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. That's in verse 24. It's kind of the middle of that section of scripture, but it really spells out why. Paul's motive, Paul's heart, Paul's desire for this whole section that we read here this morning. Number two, serving others with integrity. More than once, he said, I spent time with you. You watched my life. You saw how I worked with my hands, not trying to take advantage of people. He said, I spent 3 years with you, brothers and sisters and people watching. You spend 3 years with somebody and they know you. They know your motives. Now, they might not know every little bit about you, and people can still pull the wool over your eyes, I know. But Paul's using this to help us see or Luke's using it to help us see that people were intimately involved in the life of the Apostle Paul for 3 years in Ephesus. Number three, serving the Lord with all humility was a priority with Paul. Number four, godly leaders marked by faithful biblical teaching. It's over and over and over again in this text. We talked about it last week. That is what a church does primarily. A church is not a show that you come to every Sunday. Man, that was cool. I really got enjoyment out of that. You leave, you live out your lives disconnected to everybody that you were there with. And you can't wait for Sunday again so you can watch the show, the event. That's not what a church is. Man, if you read through Acts, I don't know how you even get to that conclusion or function that way. So the last one here is then the love of Christ demonstrated through prayer. Paul knelt with these elders and prayed with them and wept. Previously in the text there, before we get to that last section, he said, you know, I wept over you with tears, with trials. So Paul is showing the love of Christ demonstrated through the way he prays, his passion and his deep fellowship. So those are the 5 points that we're going to get to go through. We'll hope to get through them all today, but maybe not. So number one, sacrificing for others in order to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. We see that in verses 13 through 16, and we see it summarized in verse 24, how Paul sacrificed. Now, if you just joined us today, you haven't been watching. The last couple of weeks we've been preaching through Acts, and, even 8 weeks ago now when we started online, we were in Acts. There's a context that flows through this. But if you just joined us today, you might think that these verses are pretty random. Like, why would the preacher pick randomly to teach through Acts 20, starting with verse 13, and mention all these towns that I don't have a clue where they are? I don't even think he pronounced them right. So why would he start there? You could think this to be pretty random. You could think it to be pretty boring. You can hear these city names and things. I don't even know where these places are. You hear Assos and Mytilene and Chios and Samos and Miletus, and you wonder, what do any of these places have to do with anything going on in my life right now? You might say, I'm living right now under a worldwide pandemic, and this guy is pronouncing names of towns I've never heard of. Or I lost my job. Or I haven't seen my friends. Or I haven't even got to go to a movie. Or I'm not even having a graduation ceremony. Or a prom. Or I can't go on vacation this year. And you're talking about these towns and cities. Or maybe you're older and you're feeling lonely right now and isolated, and you haven't seen a human being within 6 feet, maybe someone dropping groceries off at your door or whatever, and you are just ready to go unwound. Why this text? Pastor, I'm watching today and I need something that applies to me. Oh, dear soul, let me talk to you for a minute. Let me just say that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's God-breathed, and it's profitable. It's profitable for many things in us. So don't just brush by these verses and miss the grace and the glory of God here. Don't miss seeing the deep, deep sense of love and care that Christ brings to His people, to His saints, to His church. Don't miss the togetherness, the belonging, the community, the bearing of one another's burdens displayed by the pen of Dr. Luke in the example of Paul and his associates here. And as the Spirit opens our eyes to the Word of God today, may He stir up a longing in us to all be together again and realize how precious it is. Not just to watch on a screen somewhere, but to actually be with people, hurting people. May the Lord stir your heart today to show you how deep the fellowship of the saints is. And how much you really love people that you thought maybe you didn't love before. That's what I get out of it, first off. These were real places, these were real churches, these were real people, and this is the real heart of the Apostle Paul who'd been changed. In chapter 9, previously to chapter 9, he didn't care about these people. He was out to kill them. But in chapter 9, we see the glorious conversion, what the gospel does in a person's life to give him a love for people, a love for the followers of Jesus Christ. So as the Spirit opens our eyes to the Word today, may He stir up that longing in us. Don't miss this, because it's in the text. It's on this day here that we're hearing it. For you, dear soul. So why are these towns mentioned? And why is it important to review the Apostle Paul's travel log, as it were? Because every detail reveals the grace of God. Paul was a changed man. God miraculously changed his heart, his perspective, his attitude, his understanding. You'll read about his conversion in Acts chapter 9. The gospel work of Jesus transformed this man from a terrorist to the church, to the Christians, to God's people, transforming from that to a humble, loving, caring follower of Jesus, where he weeps when he prays for them. Let me tell you, this travel log's important because travel was not convenient in Paul's day. It wasn't easy, it wasn't comfortable, and it wasn't without risk. Luke records all the travel logs in Acts throughout this book, often to show us of the selfless sacrifices and strong desire to travel the known world just to reach somebody who hadn't heard about Jesus so that they could hear how they could be reconciled to God through the gospel, the Lord Jesus Christ. But it wasn't easy. And so there comes our first point. We give of ourselves. We sacrifice. We do it so that we might testify of the gospel of the grace of God. Look at verse 24 again. Look what he says. I don't account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus Christ to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. That summarizes why Paul and his companions traveled all over. Paul's single-minded purpose was to fulfill the ministry that was given him by the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you wanted to summarize that, you could go to the vision that Ananias was given, because he was a little skeptical when the Lord spoke to him and said, hey, I'm going to send you this guy, Saul, or Paul, and you're gonna share the gospel with him. You're gonna take care of him. You're gonna minister to him. And Ananias says, "Do you know who you're sending me, Lord? Do you know who you're sending me?" And then the Lord speaks to Ananias in a vision, and he says this: "Yes, I know who I'm sending you. He is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles, before kings, before the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." That was his calling. That's what Ananias heard from God, heard from Christ about Saul. That's what Saul knew of his purpose in life, in everything, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Brothers and sisters, that's very humbling. How much do I think like that? Let alone, how much am I living like that and doing that? Again, I'm not to put you on a guilt trip. It just shows that I need to walk in the Spirit of God. How the flesh is constantly at war with the Spirit. So giving of ourselves or sacrifice for the sake of others so that we get the opportunity to testify, or let me summarize that, to boast in the gospel of the grace of God. Again, this was the Spirit's work. We're not boasting in Paul. He was not superhuman here. If you'll read Acts, you'll find out his struggles and the things that he went through. But listen, this was Paul, filled with the power of the Spirit. And so his heart is longing to be in Ephesus. He kind of knows where he's headed here. He knows he's going to be passing close to Ephesus, which if you just read a couple of chapters back, you're going to find that's where he almost lost his life, in the arena, remember? When they were shouting out, "Great is Artemis." But he wanted to go back there because there was a church there. There were God's people there. And he loved them very much. But time was constraining him, so he sends for the elders instead to meet him in Miletus. He shares with these Ephesian elders the things that are important to him. He alludes to the fact several times that this is likely the last time they'll see him, that his life, the Spirit keeps showing him that he's going to be persecuted and his life may end before he sees them again on earth. They hear that. That's why at the very last section of Scripture there, the last couple of verses 36 through 38, they were sorrowful because they remembered the words of Paul that they're not going to see him anymore. So he has this strong intuition that this is likely the last time he's going to be with the brothers in Ephesus. Number two then. And so Paul is laying out the things that are important now to these elders, to these church leaders, for the church, things that are important for the church, and specifically the elders or the leaders in the church. These are the things that should mark you. These are the things that are important. Number one, or it's actually number two in the notes, serving others with integrity. We see it in verse 18. They came to him. He said to them, you yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia. Then we see it again in verse 31. Therefore be alert, remembering that for 3 years I didn't cease night or day to admonish everyone in tears. You were like a child to me. I wept over you. How many of you have ever wept over your children? We love our children dearly, don't we? Paul took on the father figure of this church in Ephesus. And he said, even when I was with you, I didn't cease night or day to admonish everyone tearfully. Integrity. He says these things, Luke says these things about Paul to show us that integrity is important. C.S. Lewis once said this, integrity is doing the right thing even when no one else is watching. But Paul says here to these elders, people are watching. People are watching. He reminds them of that in verse 18. And when you live among a group of people, it's tough to profess one thing and live another. Guess who knows of my hypocrisy better than anyone else? The woman I'm married to. Because she lives with me. She can hear me preach a sermon like this, and she knows exactly what's going on in my life and in my heart and how much I'm relying on the Spirit's power and how much I'm walking in the flesh. Secondly, you know who knows? My kids. Why? Because I live with them. I live among them. When you live among a group of people, it's tough to profess one thing and live another. He says it again in verse 31. Remember, 3 years I didn't cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. Paul was reminding them that integrity is important. Integrity before God is important. You know, I recently read about some officials in the city of Philadelphia who were surprised to receive a letter and a payment from a motorist who had been given a speeding ticket in 1954. John Gedge had visited the city of Brotherly Love when he was cited for speeding. The penalty back then was, get this, $15. But Gedge, and apparently the city also, forgot about the ticket for almost 52 years until he put on an old coat one day to see if it would still fit, stuck his hand in the pocket, and found the speeding ticket. It's interesting. He said, I've got to pay it. 84 years old at this time. In a nursing home. Crafts in his pocket, finds the speeding ticket because he said, I want people to know I'm a man of integrity. I want my conscience to be clear before God and men. Paul wasn't sinless here, but his resolve over and over again was to be blameless. As much as it had to do with him, of course he was walking in the Spirit, he wanted men, when they heard his name, to honor Christ. As followers of Jesus, we're called to walk in integrity and to maintain a clear conscience before God. When we walk in the forgiveness of Christ, again, because we're not perfect, we have to rely on the grace and the forgiveness of Christ. When we walk in that forgiveness, we're readily willing to forgive others because we realize the trespasses we've had against God. And in doing all this, we walk in fellowship with God. Integrity authenticates our profession of the gospel and opens doors for us to continue sharing it. It authenticates. Saints in the church, integrity is important, and Paul points that out in verses 18 and 31. Those of you that maybe aren't involved in a church, looking for a church where the leaders are walking in integrity. I'm not talking about perfect men. And leaders around me know I'm not perfect. They've seen my attitude. They've seen me go off in a huff at times. They've seen all kinds of things in me that were not the Spirit of God. They were the flesh of Wally Weeks. But they know, and we all know, one another's hearts. We want to be blameless. We want to walk in integrity. We want to be able to have you trust us. Number three, serving the Lord with humility. Acts 20:19 says it, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears. There's that word tears again, and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews. How I didn't shrink back, I didn't hold back from declaring to you, even when it meant toughness, you know, for me on my part. It wasn't popular on my part. I didn't shrink back from proclaiming to you things that were profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house. So Paul's humble servant attitude flavors, again, this entire passage. But notice that he mentions specifically that he is serving the Lord with all humility. Serving the Lord. The word serving there is the verb related in the Greek to the word or the noun bondservant. Bondservant would mean a willing slave. A bondservant is a willing slave. In other words, bondservants were those that if you said you can be released, they may have said, I love my master. I'll remain here. I'm willing, a willing slave. We don't belong to ourselves. We are bondservants or willing slaves of Jesus Christ, as Paul points out in Romans 1:1, Galatians 1:10, Colossians 1:7, Colossians 4:7, Titus 1:1. All these verses, Paul uses that same word, that same understanding. A bond slave, a serving, humility. This means that the leader primarily serves the Lord, but secondarily serves the church. Every elder or pastor or leader will give account to God someday for how he fulfilled the stewardship that was entrusted to him. If other elders question one of the elders' behavior and he piously answers back, listen, I don't answer to you. I answer to God. That is often pride. But there is a legitimate sense in which a godly leader realizes that he will answer to God, and it keeps him from becoming a man pleaser. We see that in Paul's writing to the Galatian church in Galatians 1:10. He says, am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be the servant of Christ. And then 1 Thessalonians 2:4. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so then we speak not to please man, but to please God who tests our hearts. So there's this two sides of the coin here. We want to be humble when other elders step into our lives, when other people step into our lives even. We want to be humble and not say, look, I was called by God, not by you, so you don't know what you're talking about. We don't answer back that way. But yet, when there are issues where we have to stand firm, God is the one I answer to. When we see ourselves as servants of Jesus Christ, we'll serve others out of love. Lording it over others is the world's way. It was the pattern of the way that this church in Ephesus would have seen. And so Paul wants to remind these elders gently, listen, we're not like the world. We're not like what is going on in Ephesus in the culture right now. We are servant-like elders shepherding the church as a shepherd would kindly shepherd sheep. Christ's way, not the world's way, is the greatest. And he said, if you want to be greatest among him, you'd be the servant of all. That's in Mark 10. I'm reminded of two mountain climbers who reached the top of Mount Everest in 1963. That was the year I was born. As Sherpa Gombu from Tibet and Jim Whitaker from the U.S. approached the peak, each one considered the honor of being the first two men known to summit Mount Everest. Whitaker motioned for Gombu to go ahead, but Gombu declined with a smile, saying, "Nope, you first, Big Jim." Finally, they decided to both step onto the summit at the same time. At the same time, the Apostle Paul encouraged the elders from the church in Ephesus to demonstrate this kind of humility. Selfishness and superiority divides people, but humility builds bridges and opens hearts. Paul encouraged these church leaders that through trials and suffering and tears, we should remain humble in our service to the Lord, reflecting his own life. Humility calls us to show grace and gentleness rather than our own way. Ooh. It's convicting. Because how many times does Wally want his own way over the stuff that doesn't even matter? And I'll run right over people and hurt their feelings just because I think I'm the pastor. Serving the Lord with all humility means backing away from what we want for us and doing what is best for others. Serving the Lord with all humility. It's important to Paul. Is it important to you? Or is it about you all the time? Number four, godly leaders are marked by faithful biblical teaching. Al Mohler writes, Paul's exhortation to the Ephesian elders provides a helpful and desperately needed paradigm for Christian leaders in the 21st century. Ministry consists of service, teaching the saints, and preaching the gospel of repentance. Did you see that in the text? That's what ministry consists of. That's what was important to Paul. When you preach, when you lay out the word here, Mohler goes on to say, ministry must be about bringing people to Christ through the ministry of reconciliation. Paul did not serve to advance his own fame. He served to ensure that God's grace toward him would not be in vain. And we hear that again over in 1 Corinthians. That's the end of Mohler's quote there. But listen to 1 Corinthians 15:10. Paul speaks these words, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. Listen to that. His grace towards me was not in vain. My salvation, the reason he saved me is not in vain. He goes on to say this. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them. Though, listen, this is the most important part of it. It was not I, but the grace of God that was working in me. Being saved doesn't mean you get lazy spiritually. I mean, look at that in Paul's life, in Paul's example here in these verses. He goes from town to town to town, getting on ship, walking while the others sailed on ship, landing in all these places, loving this Ephesian church, but he doesn't have the time to get to them right now, but because he's trying to get to Jerusalem. All of these things going on. This is his third missionary journey. He's already been on two others. He's suffered everything under the hands of men, tempests and storms and all these kinds of things. It was the grace of God working in him. So leaders and churches are marked by a lot of things these days. They're marked by how dynamic a communicator the pastor is. They're marked by how entertaining they are, or how cool they are, or how cool the music or the praise team is, or what they do for kids, or whether or not they have a cafe. That's the way people choose churches nowadays. How funny the pastor is. How relevant the pastor is. How nice the building is. What technology they use, and now we've added another one to it. How visually stimulating they are on Facebook or YouTube. Do you hear any of that in this text? Do you hear any of that of any importance to Paul at all in a church? No, he says, make sure you have servant leadership. Make sure the church is serving one another. Make sure the church has integrity, that what they say they believe they're living out by the grace of God. And then he says the faithfulness of God's word is important. I'm going to run down through these. Get your Bible open. Because I want you to look at this and see this. I'm going to try not to commentate on these. But this is great stuff. Look at this. I mean, godly leaders are marked by faithful biblical teaching. Look at verse 20 in Acts 20. I did not hold back or shrink back from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both the Jews and the Greeks of what? Of what? Of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. That was his message. God made you. You have gone your own way. Sin has taken us down that road. We were born sinners. We need to turn from what we think and what we want and turn back to God
by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Acts 20:24, that I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus. Look, to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Repentance toward God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ in 20 and 21 and 24 testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Verse 25, look at it. I know that none of you among whom I have gone about, look what he's doing, proclaiming the kingdom, are going to see my face again, at least in this world. Acts 20, 25, and 26, therefore I testify to you on this day that I am innocent of the blood of all. Why? Because I didn't hold back from declaring the whole counsel of God, not just the parts we like. Paul took the scriptures in the Old Testament and pointed to Jesus Christ through them. He preached the whole counsel of God. Acts 20:28. Pay careful attention then to yourselves. Pay careful attention then to yourselves. If you're listening this morning, what does this sermon have to do with me? Pay careful attention then to yourselves. And to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Now he's specifically talking to the elders, the leaders of that church there. That's the context. Acts 20, 29, look at it. I know that after my departure, why? Why does he want all of these things to be in place? And why are these things the marks of a healthy church? Because after I am gone, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. False teachers. People teaching something different than what the Lord Jesus Christ taught. Something different than the gospel. And he calls people like that, teachers like that, fierce wolves. And from among you, your own selves will arise men. Even in the church, there's going to be people rising up, speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Verse 32. And now I commend you to God and to what? The word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Acts 20:35. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. What is a church about, brothers and sisters? You having a good old time? You feeling good about yourself? Listen, those things are not bad. But we're to preach God's word. We're to teach God's word. We're to hold people to the standard of God's word. Leaders in your churches are not those that can entertain you. They're the ones that can rightly divide God's word to you. You don't want to be, if you're not in a church right now, you don't want to find a church that tantalizes you and entertains you. You want a church that will rightly divide the scriptures, that will talk truth to you. A church that is a community. And we'll get into that in this last point here. But listen, those verses that I just read, 20 through 35 there, they're rich with the importance of speaking the truth. What was important to the Apostle Paul was that these elders held to the truth of Scripture, that looked to God's Word, that directed everything by the Word of God. And now Paul brings us to this tearful close as he vulnerably bears his heart to these elders and to us this morning. In Acts 20:36 through 38, the love of Christ demonstrated through prayer, passion, and deep fellowship. You see that? Much weeping. There's kissing. There's sorrow. They're accompanying him to the ship. They can't let the guy go. They love this man deeply, and he loves them deeply. And this is all conveyed by Luke in this text. What do you hear in these verses, brothers and sisters? That Paul deeply loved the people of God at Ephesus. Do you deeply love the people of God in your church? Or is your church just a spectator event? You don't even know the people of God. Listen, church. It wasn't meant to be an event every Sunday. And that's part of the reason, man, I really struggle with this online thing. Because you're not here. I can't hug you. I can't look you in the eye. I can't. If you were here and I was preaching this sermon, I would probably be weeping right now. It's not meant to be an event. Church is not a place where you go and take in a show and then leave until next week and take in another show. The church is a community of God's people who live life under the lordship of Jesus Christ with accountability and with love together.
And that's why it's so hard for this church not to be together. I mean, when we leave now, we just make sure, you know, the video's worked all right, and then we go home. But on any given Sunday at Pleasant View Baptist Church, people are here an hour after the service, weeping and talking and praying and laughing and enjoying each other's company. And that's the way it should be. Can you imagine Paul then kneeling before these men and crying out to God on their behalf to the point of tears? Brothers and sisters, the way you love people right now especially, but always, but right now especially, is you pray for them because you can't be with them. You pray for them. You go through your phone book this week or your directory or your text list or whatever, you know, on your phone, and you start saying, Lord, give me a purpose. Help me to call 3 or 4 people a day and just pray for them and encourage them and tell them, I heard this sermon out of the book of Acts here 20, and this was important to Paul, and I see now it's important to God, and it's important to me, and I want you to know that I love you and I care about you and I can't be with you right now. So, this is where we land the plane. May our loving Lord strengthen us to generously give the gift of our prayers today for others. Prayer and passion and tears here. Look at that. Prayer and passion and tears are all part of this text. Let me summarize it again. Verse 24, that I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. How many days do you have left? You don't know, do you? Even our song of the month, it lends to the fact that, hey, we're all going to pass, we're all going to die, but we have hope in Christ. How many days do you have left? I don't know, but I'm going to take up that verse, that I might finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus, that every day of my life I want to testify to the gospel of the grace of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your word this morning. As our praise team comes right now to sing a few songs before we close this service, Lord, would you take these words and would you drive them deep into our hearts, and would you use this for your glory and the good of your people and the good of your church? Would you put that yearning, stir it up even more, that deep, deep yearning to be together. It's not a bad thing. It's a great thing, Lord. For those who aren't a part of a church, Lord, would you show them the togetherness that we have? Would you stir up a holy jealousy in them that when we can get back together, they would come see us if they're not part of another church and be a part of a community that wants to honor you and your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, a common thing these last few weeks, and it is common here on a Sunday morning as well, to say, as the Lord would have you respond, we're just simply saying, be obedient to respond how the Lord would have you respond. Let's sing this together. 2, 3. Is mine.
Still remains.
healed the blind, the lost, and the lame. Even now he is in our midst. Behold him, he who chose a criminal sin, paid with blood to settle our debt, buried death as he rose to life.
So much for singing there at home, and let me send you with this benediction from 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things
at all times, you may abound in every good work. Amen. You may abound in every good work because of Christ Jesus who lives in you. Amen. So go be a blessing this week and have a wonderful week. Thank you so much for joining us again this week here on live stream. And till we meet here physically, we're looking forward to that day. Christ will be a hideaway. Find hope in this as Andrew exits with this song. Christ will be my hideaway.